rocks are rough on him, so let's keep him in our prayers. Michael Jarnigan is slowly improving from his heart surgery. Anna Jean Hester is about the same with her pregnancies. She continues her bed rest. All is well so far. Larson Plyler is supposed to consult with his doctors soon for a treatment plan. Jo Catherine King is at home and is doing a little bit better. Colleen Smith is a little bit better, but she's still having some pain. She's been able to come out today, so we certainly hope that she can have some relief from her pain. Pam Skidmore is feeling better and is improving. David Hogan will have shoulder surgery Monday week, so let's keep him in our prayers and I hope that the surgery goes well and gives him some relief from the pain that he is suffering. Are there any other sick that we need to make mention of? There's a couple of meetings in our area, Eastside and Russellville, today through the 25th with Justin Robertson. They will meet Monday through Friday night at 7. Hillsborough Heights, August 27th through the 31st with Ken Chapman. Sundays at 9, 10, and 3. Monday through Thursday at 7. We're certainly glad to have Brother Jake with us. We've been mentioning him on military duty, and I think he has to go back Tuesday. So let's continue to keep him in our prayers. And Raymond Hester recently had military duty, and he's at home also. Let's also remember our shut-ins, Adeline Scott, Rowan Linda Hughes, Charlene Boyd, Millerine Hargett, Sue Taylor, and Linda King. And those in our community, Bobby Miller, Gerald Ricketts, and Willie's uncle, Willie Lindsay. And also, Trenton and Emily Barksdale will be having a singing at their house on September the 3rd after evening services. And everyone is invited. Are there any other announcements that we need to make? Not at this time, we'll have our opening prayer.
Let's pray.
Heavenly Father, we come before you this time so thankful for the day and for your greatness and your goodness and your love and your mercy towards us that allows us to be here this evening. So thankful for this time and opportunity that we have to assemble together as Christians, as your children, to worship you, the only true living God. We pray that things that we do here this evening might be pleasing and acceptable in accordance with your will. Pray that you be with Terry this evening as he brings the lesson to us. Give him a good remembrance of the things that he is prepared to teach. Pray that we might listen with open minds and open Bibles, that we might apply those things to our lives to help us live our life each day better than we have in the past. Help us to always live to glorify your name and bring souls to you. We're mindful of the list, Heavenly Father, that Brother Frankie just mentioned. So many that are sick, that desire interest in our prayers. Be with them, be with the doctors, be with their families. Help them regain their health and be in accordance with your will. We're mindful and thankful for those that were mentioned that have received good reports and have overcome their sicknesses. And for that, we give you the glory and the praise for their recovery. And we pray that you continue to be with them, be the doctors that may tend to them, and pray that they may stay free of sickness and that their health may stay in a condition that they desire. We're mindful of our governing officials the world over. Be with them. Help them to always make decisions that allow us this freedom to worship you, the one true living God. Pray that more nations around the world might be able to have this same freedom that we have so that your name may be spread and glorified in all the earth. we go throughout this service, that we always do these things here in this place in accordance with your will. Go with us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Our first song this evening will be number 730 in our books, and What a Friend We Have in Jesus.
Soldiers of Christ, arise.
position will be number 634 in the red book. And that's a great position.
Okay, good to see everybody out tonight. Hope you are ready to indulge in some good sightseeing and study of the Word of God. So we've been doing the context and setting of great Bible events, and we got to Beth Shean was our last place, so that's what we'll be looking at tonight. Identify Beth Shean in the storyline that you know. You remember Saul was killed on Mount Gilboa nearby, and then the Philistines took his body and pinned his body to the wall in Beth Shean. So that's where we'll be picking up and looking tonight. Let's see if I can get the spills out into what we call this the Jordan Valley. So this blue represents the Jordan River, and it flows from from the Sea of Galilee down to the Dead Sea. All right, so this whole valley where the Jordan River is, that's called the Jordan River Valley. So all this gray represents lowland. So in the spring of Herod, we saw we were looking toward Mount Gilboa, and we were looking at it in the distance. But if we make our way down to Beth Shean, and there's also something I want to show you. God didn't let me advance now. All right, here we go. Go back. Here's a map that helps us a little bit but you'll have to notice we had been up on Mount Carmel earlier in our series, and we were looking at this green area, looking down from Mount Carmel down into the green area, and that we were saying that's the Jezreel Valley, as you can see here. And then we were at the spring of Herod, and this green kind of spills out into a greenery down into the Jordan Valley. So here's where we're going to be looking today, is Beth Shean, located right there. All right. Now, this kind of gives you an aerial view, helps you to see where Beth Shean, sometimes pronounced Beth Shean or Beth Shean, and you can see how Mount Gilboa is real nearby. This was the mountain on which great battles were fought. And the Philistines captured and killed, or at least found Saul, killing himself. He fell on his own sword. You can read this in 1 Samuel chapter 31. So let's look at that. Look at 1 Samuel 31. It says in 1 Samuel 31, starting with verse 1, it says, "So the Philistines fought against Israel, and the men of Israel fled from before the Philistines, and fell slain on Mount Gilboa. And the Philistines followed hard after Saul and his sons, and the Philistines killed Jonathan, Abinadab, and Malchishua, Saul's sons. Now the battle became intense against Saul. And he was severely wounded by the archers. And then Saul said to his armor bearer, draw your sword and thrust me through with it, lest these uncircumcised men come and thrust me through and abuse me. But his armor bearer would not, for he was greatly afraid, and therefore Saul took a sword and fell on it. And when his armor bearer saw that Saul was dead, he also fell on his sword and died with him. So Saul, his three sons, his armor bearer, and all his men died together that same day. And when the men of Israel who were on the other side of the valley and those who were on the other side of the Jordan saw that the men of Israel had fled and that Saul and his sons were dead, they forsook the cities and fled, and the Philistines came and dwelt with them. That kind of gives you a picture of this land mass here. Some on the other side of the valley, some on the other side of the Jordan. You can almost see through the fog or whatever I don't know if you can see way on the cross there, but you can see, almost see the Jordan River flowing through there. So you've got Beth Shean is near enough for people to find out quickly about these kind of things, especially military signals that you could send. And so from Mount Gilboa, we're going to see them, the Philistines, take his body and move downhill. So it came to pass the next day, verse 8, when the Philistines came to strip the slain, that they found Saul and his three sons fallen on Mount Gilboa. They cut off his head, stripped off his armor, and sent word throughout the land of the Philistines to proclaim it in the temple of their idols and among the people. So they're going to take his body to one of their temples. And that was one of their temples was in Beth Shean. They put his armor in the temple of the Ashtoreths. And they fastened his body to the wall in Beth Shean. That's our place that we'll be looking at. And when the inhabitants of Jabesh Gilead heard what the Philistines had done to Saul, all the valiant men arose and traveled all night and took the body of Saul and the bodies of his sons from the wall of Beth Shean, and they came to Jabesh and burned them there, and they took their bones and buried them under the tamarisk tree at Jabesh and fasted 7 days. So there's the story, interesting story of how God's first anointed king in Israel fell to the Philistines. And a lot of this all because even back in the days of the judges and even as far back as the book of Joshua, they didn't run all the inhabitants out of the land, and so it was always a thorn in their side. So we arrive at Beth Shean National Park, and I want us to get oriented to see that big hill in the background there. That's a tell on which the original Beth Shean was. It was later taken over by the Israelites, but it was also taken over by the Romans later as we get close to the first century. And the Romans built a lot of things. And so you can see in this picture a lot of the architecture that is clearly Roman architecture, things that are associated with the Roman Empire. But up on the hill, there's a walkway that takes you up on top of the hill. And up there, there is a different kind of building structure. Now, all of it's falling down, all we see is the base of it. But even with that, you can see that the architecture of the Egyptians is much different than the architecture of the Romans. And both of them a little bit different than the Canaanites. So you have a little bit of all of these civilizations flowing in and out and taking possession of this. So let's open our Bibles to learn a little bit more about Beth Shean. So looking at Joshua chapter 17, I want you to notice this statement here, Joshua 17, and I'm looking at verse 16. Joshua 17, verse 16, says, but the children of Joseph, now remember Joseph had children, Manasseh and Ephraim, so these are the children of Joseph that should have occupied Bethshean and been in total control of it. So the children of Joseph, this was back when children of Joseph should have taken possession of all of the land in the time of Joshua. Okay? So the children of Joshua said, the mountain country is not enough for us, and all the Canaanites who dwell in the land of the valley, you can remember that scene that we showed you, Mount Gilboa and all the valley around. Says those that dwell in the valley have chariots of iron, so they didn't do what they needed to because they let fear of the mighty armies of the Canaanites intimidate them. So it says, both those who are of Bethshean, that's our place that we're looking at, and its towns, and those who are of the valley of Jezreel, remembering what we saw just a moment ago. And Joshua spoke to the house of Joseph, to Ephraim and Manasseh, saying, you are a great people and have great power. You shall not have one lot only, in other words, don't limit yourself. And he's trying to make sure that they don't limit themselves mentally. But the mountain country shall be yours, although it is wooded, you shall cut it down, and its farthest extent shall be yours, for you shall drive out the Canaanites, though they have iron chariots and are strong. You can tell this was, Bethshean was a fortress city, and especially was it very conducive to that, to have part of their city on this mountain, because from there you can look down into the Jordan Valley, see what's trying to come across the Jordan. You can see what's coming in the Jezreel Valley. You're looking all around, and so you have a strategic location militarily. And so that was one of the reasons why the Canaanites were able to keep the Israelites from taking possession of it, is that it was intimidating to them to see that they had such a military force with chariots and horses, and those kind of things back then were powerful tools to use in the military. So up there on the top, you're going to see the Temple of Ashtoreth, a little bit of the remains there. You're going to also see up there some remains of the governor's house, who was an Egyptian. An Egyptian governor was there. So Egyptians early on had taken possession and found this was very strategic to them. Having a fortress area here helped them to control the flow from Assyria and Babylon and all around. It would flow through this area and then make their way down to Egypt. It was good to have a governor strategically located at Bethshean. All right, the next passage along this line is Judges chapter 1, verse 27. We'll get over to the Judges now. It says, Manasseh did not drive out the inhabitants of Bethshean and its villages, or Taanach and its villages, or the inhabitants of Dor and its villages, or the inhabitants of Ibleam and its villages, or the inhabitants of Megiddo, one of those places we visited earlier, and its villages, for the Canaanites were determined. They were determined to dwell in that land. In other words, they were more determined to stay there than the Israelites were determined to force them out. And so it was a long time before the Israelites could actually take possession of this strategic location. And that's where we saw that Saul, the first king, was not able to take possession of this either, and his body was hung there ever so temporarily. But it was hung there, so the enemy was still there, and that was a way of showing off that we're in control of the Israelite people. Don't you be afraid of the Israelite people. Then we turn to 2 Samuel chapter 21, and you have this recorded for us, that Shem is mentioned again. 21 verse 12. Now we're in the days of David. So we had Saul. They didn't have possession of Bethshean then. We have David now. And David was told that Rizpah, the daughter of Ai, the concubine of Saul, was told what she had done. And then David went and took the bones of Saul and the bones of Jonathan his son from the men of Jabesh, Gilead, who had stolen them from the street of Bethshan, where the Philistines had hung them up after the Philistines had struck down Saul in Gilboa. So the accounts keep a consistent story about what happened to Saul, and we've got that. So now we wonder, well, when did the children of Israel get better control of Bethshean? I want you to take a look at an aerial view here. So up on the mountain there, you can see a civilization was there, and then you have the lower land civilization. The mound represents early Canaanite and Egyptian fortress. The lower became later on Roman Decapolis, or at least part of the Decapolis. Decapolis means that there's 10 strategic cities, Deca meaning 10, and so a part of the 10 was the great city of Bethshean. And you see also in other passages that it was also named Scythopolis, so the Scythians occupied this place for a time. So people in and out in these different battles through time saw the strategic nature of this particular city and kept a stronghold there for their own purposes. But Solomon later took control of this city and built some fortified walls there himself. Now those things are hard to locate in all of this, because the Romans then later took over and they started building their own things. All right, so that's an aerial view of this structure. Now we're looking again, and I want you to notice the hill and the walkway up there. We'll be going up that walkway. Here we go. The walkway. This right here is part of the Roman city. And you had shops on every side of this pathway. And we'll talk about that in a little more in just a minute. But the Roman structures that you can see here, many of those were present during the time of Jesus. And I want you to notice that many people were touched by the ministry of Jesus Christ. I'm looking at Mark chapter 4, verse 25, Mark 4. Verse 25. No, that's Matthew 4, verse 25. Excuse me. Matthew 4, verse 25. This is soon after Jesus' ministry was getting started. It says, great multitudes followed him from Galilee and from Decapolis, meaning all of the cities of Decapolis, including, of course, Bethshan. Jerusalem, people from Judea and beyond the Jordan. So we've got, you know, statements that tell us locations, and you get a visual of where to place all of those things. Then in Mark's account, and I'm looking at Mark chapter 5. Now, Mark chapter 5. Verse 17, it says, they began to plead with him to depart said to him, go home to your friends and tell them what great things the Lord has done for you and how he has had compassion on you. And he departed and began to proclaim in Decapolis. So that would be the general region in which these 10 major Roman strategic cities were located. And those were mostly on the west side of the Sea of Galilee, the Jordan, but some of it was on the east side. The east side, and of course this is on the west side. Bethshean is on the west side of the Jordan. All right, so it says he departed again, proclaimed in all the Decapolis all that Jesus had done for him, and all marveled. So Jesus had an impact in this strategic location, and a lot of people were influenced by him there. This is an artist's rendition, an archaeologist's rendition of what the city would have looked like had you got all that debris and built it back up and put it back in place. This would have been about what you would have seen in part of that city. This is us going up the hill now to get on the top of that mount. When we get up there, we will see the remains, but here's an artist's rendition of what is there, of a 12th century Egyptian administrative center, at least a house that headquartered the Egyptian governor. And here's what you can see. You can see the difference in the style of the Egyptians. You go to Egypt and see, well, that's a totally different architectural structure, a different kind of style. The Romans had their own style. Here you can see that Egypt had some impact on this area as well. So we got that on top of the mound. This is on the edge where they think that Saul's body would have been pinned, so that all there in the upper structure and the lower structure should have viewed his body, that there was a wall here. And they have that tree that's kind of, or at least the dead tree, to help preserve the spot that they think. And that's not necessarily the spot, but it's the spot where Saul's body was thought to have been hung ever so briefly, not on the tree, but on a wall that was near this tree. And there's Stan and Carlin. And then we've got, looking down from that, you can look down and you can see various Roman structures. The street that we're talking, the Palladius Street. And when over here you have the typical Roman theater. You have a bunch of those scattered throughout the Roman world, and so typically in great cities they would have structures like this, Roman theaters. And over here we have Roman baths, and we have located in various parts. I think I'll get to some of that here. Still looking down on some of the debris of the Roman period. Here's some of the entrance way into the theater. So we were over there looking back over here to the theater. We were over on the mountain, over that structure. And then now we're looking from the theater back toward the mountain. Here's the floor, at least some of the flooring of the bathhouse. And what they would do is they would have flooring over this, and then they would use the air underneath to heat the water on top. And so that would be one of the things that you would see now, letting the hot air pass under the floor and heat the water. You had a main street of the Palladium that we've been looking at, both from up on top of the hill and from the theater position as well. And this is a public restroom. And then you also have another angle on the street, the Palladium Street. You have an explanation sign of that street. It says this street, built on Roman foundations, was one of the more eloquent boulevards in Byzantine Bethshean, 4th to 6th centuries. The sidewalks were roofed. In other words, it wasn't open like that. It had roof over the sidewalks and paved with mosaics. The excavators named the street after Palladius, a 4th century governor of the city, who is mentioned in an inscription found in one of the mosaic pavements. So it's interesting to see all of the different influences that have come to bear on this very popular place, very popular to the Canaanites, very popular to the Egyptian, very popular to the children of Israel, to Saul, very popular to Solomon to build build at least some walls to defend the place better during his time. And then, of course, the Romans thought it was a very strategic place for them as well. Different views. So this, to me, was one of the more impressive places as far as having so much there that's represented there. And I was very impressed with the remains that you could see of the Roman culture, at least. All right, so now we're looking toward the theater again. I like the red dot. All right, so we got Palladium Street. It goes up toward that tall tail that we were looking off from a while ago, and we were looking in the distance at the Roman Theater. All of that is right there together. Here's a view back toward the hill. What I want you to notice in this is the Jordan Valley to the side there. To the right side, you can see the Jordan Valley in a lot of the Jordan area today. This is a model. You have, before you get into all of that stuff, they put a model of what it would have looked like in the days of Jesus in the first century. So you have all of the walkway covered, and you see up on the mountain here. Sometimes it's just not going to work, does it? All right. Maybe I need to hold my jaw right. There we go. That worked. All right, so there's the mound, and there's the temple that would have been represented there. I want you to see now, as we're leaving Bethshean, and we're moving down the valley, the Jordan River Valley. So here we were, Bethshean here, all of this Jordan River Valley, and we're going to make our way down to Jericho. Here, Jericho is right here. Because we finished our stay at Tiberias, and we are moving all of our luggage and everything. We're going to be winding up on this day at a hotel in Jerusalem. But on the way, there are a lot of interesting things to see. It's not all desert. The farther south that you get, like down in Jerusalem and down below that and over toward the Dead Sea, yes, it's really barren desert land, but everything that we saw north of Galilee, the Sea of Galilee, was very flush. A lot of different kinds of plant life, and of course, orchards galore. I mean, it's just amazing. Here is some of what we saw on the way down the valley. Of course, if you're in the Jordan River Valley, you're going to be, it's accessible to good, clean, clear water, and therefore, you're going to have more greenery there. When you get down to the Dead Sea, is not a water source that gives life. It gives death. It doesn't allow much to grow. So, on the way down, you can see scenes like this, and this is a date palm grove. There were many of those that we were able to And Jericho itself is in an area that has a lot of greenery around it. In fact, it had that going for it, even in the days when the children of Israel tried to cross over into the land of Canaan, they saw a lot of greenery here. Jericho lays claim to being the oldest city on the earth. And they're making that claim here, that they're the oldest city on the earth. In the background of Jericho, you have the mound area that held the fortress area during the days of the Canaanites in the land. And when Joshua went there, the spies went in, and Rahab, the harlot, lived there, and she protected the spies. I want you to notice the statement that's made about that back in Deuteronomy. I'm looking at Deuteronomy 34. I want you to notice verses 1 through 3. Deuteronomy 34. This is before Joshua took the leadership. This is Moses now. So we're looking in Moses' time, and Moses' death occurs. All right, so it says, then Moses went up from the plains of Moab to Mount Nebo, to the top of Pisgah, which is across from Jericho. We'll be able to look at some of the mountain ranges that's across from Jericho. The Lord showed him all the land of Gilead as far as Dan. In other words, you could look up the Jordan Valley and see a long way. On a clear day, you could see a long way up the valley. And all Naphtali and the land of Ephraim and Manasseh. And remember, Manasseh and Ephraim, their land should have taken Bethshean into consideration too, and should have occupied that. So Naphtali, all Naphtali, the land of Ephraim, Manasseh, Moses could see all of that from Mount Nebo, all the land of Judah as far as the western sea. And they see across even as far as the Mediterranean Sea, which is the western sea here, the south and the plain of the valley of Jericho, the city, notice this, the city of palm trees, as far as Zoar. So Jericho was the city of palm trees, and we'll notice that in the slides here. So we're standing on the ground, and we're looking up at the area that was the area that the children of Israel would have marched around. That would be the area in the background there. Children of Israel could easily have marched around that seven times on the seventh day. So, and there's just another angle on that. So we're not talking about a lot of land, like miles and miles. We're just talking, I don't know how many acres is involved. So they could easily march around that one day, march around it again another day, and then on the seventh day, march around seven times, and then blow their trumpets, and they got God's hand involved in bringing this strategic city down. Now we're standing on the top. This is my daughter, and she's looking out from there, and you can see, yes, it's a city of palms, as the Bible says. Here's another angle. From here, now we're not on Mount Nebo, and Mount Nebo is across on the other side, where Moses could look this way and he could see all of this land. We're on Jericho, the mound of Jericho, and we're looking south. Now, if you could have a clear day, and we could see it with our eyes on this day, but you probably can't see it in this picture. But you could see part of the Dead Sea from Jericho. You could see a lot of the mountain ranges that incorporate Mount Nebo that Moses looked across into this land from. So you can also see that this is still a city of palms, as the Bible describes. And now we're looking at away from Jericho in another direction. We're looking some of the land away from the city of palms. This is what Jesus would have seen when he came through here. Remember, Jesus came through in his ministry, and that's where he met Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus was up in a sycamore tree and wanting to anxiously see Jesus. So Jesus walked by here, and this is some of the scenery that's still there. The scenery is the same. Palm trees are the same. Everything that was there in the Bible is the same. So they haven't taken great bulldozers and created these mountains. These are what has been there all along. And this is some of the route that Jesus would have taken. So this is the scenery that Jesus would have seen. Now, here, I want us just to make note that the archaeologists are laying out for us a vision of what the groundwork, the different civilizations, and so there are different levels of this. It had been crushed, brought down during the time of the Israelites coming in to take possession of the land, but then later on it's taken over with some other civilizations, and so there's a lot of buildup from that, but they're saying you can tell the different kinds of layers and about the time periods of that, and so you can see Jericho at the time of Joshua is in some of the ruins here. And we're back up on the mountain. We're looking at the city. We're seeing that the city of Jericho is today very a very relatively large city, and a lot of people are occupying this place. But of course, they're leaving there the strategic location of the city that was brought down during the days of Joshua. Okay, we're looking from the mound to another direction and seeing again how large the city is, some of the hills around it, some of the hills that Jesus would have walked by, hills around Jericho. So on one side you've got mountains. The other side of the valley across the Jordan, you see Mount Nebo and all of that. You see the Jordan that flows down into the Sea of the Dead Sea. And you see the steps that go up on old Jericho. And then, of course, you can visualize easily the marching around old Jericho is not that hard. And this is Laura. With a camel on her neck. She's getting some camel blood right here. Anyway, I just thought that was kind of humorous. This is Leon reading. And I think it's just really good to start at these places that we're at and just read the Bible. Read the Bible because the Bible is history. So let's look at Joshua chapter 6. And I want to make some observations about the destruction of Jericho. Number one, I want you to notice how it is worded. In chapter 6, verse 1, Joshua 6, verse 1 says, "Now Jericho was securely shut up because of the children of Israel. None went out and none came in." Well, I can visualize that now. Because that was that mound area, and you can easily encompass that and make sure nobody comes in or out. Now, they're feeling pretty secure in there because it's not easy to get in either, so they're feeling pretty secure on the inside of Jericho. And the Lord said to Joshua, "See, I have given," underscore that word given, because that will play an important reminder that we are saved by God's gift. God gives us salvation. God gave Jericho to the children of Israel. They didn't earn it. They didn't work so as to earn it. So God's gifts can be given even if there are conditions attached to getting it. That doesn't make it any less a gift. "So I've given Jericho in your hand, its king. King and the Mighty Men of Valor. I did that. I mean, that's already as good as done. When God says, I'm giving it, I'll give it. It's as good as done. You shall march around the city. Here's the condition. You shall march around the city, all you men of war. You shall go all around the city once. This you shall do 6 days. Seven priests shall bear seven trumpets of ram's horns before the ark. But the seventh day you shall march around the city seven times, and the priests shall blow the trumpets. And then it shall come to pass, when they make a long blast with the ram's horn, and when you hear the sound of the trumpet, that all the people shall shout with a great shout. Then the wall of the city will fall down flat, and the people shall go up, every man straight before him. So Joshua the son of Nun called the priests and said to them, take up the ark of the covenant, and let seven priests bear seven trumpets of ram's horns before the ark of the Lord. And he said to the people, proceed and march around the city, and let him who is armed advance before the ark of the Lord. And so it was, when Joshua had spoken to the people, that the seven priests bearing the seven trumpets of ram's horns before the Lord advanced and blew the trumpets, and the ark of the covenant of the Lord followed them. The armed men went before the priests who blew the trumpets, and the rear guard came up after the ark while the priests continued blowing the trumpets. Now that doesn't sound like a real strategic military way of doing things. But this is what God told them to do, and this is what they're doing. And I'm sure people in the city of Jericho are looking out and seeing these Israelites and say, we're pretty safe in here. And that's pretty ridiculous what they're doing out there. Now, Joshua had commanded the people, saying, you shall not shout or make any noise. So they're just walking around the city very quietly these 7 days. Don't make any noise with your voice, nor shall any word proceed out of your mouth until the day I'll say to you, shout, and then you'll shout. So he had the ark of the Lord circle the city, going around it once. Then they came into the camp and lodged in the camp. Joshua rose early in the morning, and the priests took up the ark of the Lord. Then seven priests, bearing the seven trumpets of ram's horns, before the ark of the Lord, went on continually and blew the trumpets. And the armed men went before them, but the rear guard came up after the ark of the Lord, while the priests continued blowing the trumpets. The second day, they marched around the city once and returned to the camp. And so they did, consecutively, the 6 days. Came to pass, on the seventh day, that they rose early, about the dawning of the day, and marched around the city seven times in the same manner. On that day only, they marched around the city seven times, and the seventh time it was so, when the priests blew the trumpets, and Joshua said to the people, shout, for the Lord has given you the city. Now, some people might argue, if you have to do anything, it's not a gift, that you're earning it. Not so. This is not work that involves trying to earn anything. The Lord still gives the city to the children of Israel, in spite of the fact that he attached to that gift, there are conditions you've got to make. And those conditions are, do what I say here. It's not going to earn you anything, but that's when you'll be given the city. All right, so he says, shout, for the Lord has given you the city. Now, the city shall be doomed by the Lord to destruction, it and all who are in it. Only Rahab the harlot shall live, she and all who are with her in the house, because she hid the messengers that we sent. And you, by all means, keep yourselves from the accursed things. And we'll see if some problems that came as a result of that. But it's interesting to me that to stand here you're seeing once again, repeatedly, that the Bible story is not myth. It is designed to be read as historical fact. And it tells exact places. It describes the scenery in many cases of the place, like palm trees here, a city of palms. It's very, very accurate in the details that it brings to the table, so that if you did go to that land and search it out, you'd say, well, we're talking about real time, real places, real events. That's the way we should read the Bible. Every day, read it, because it really addresses the needs of your soul. It really does. It will give you the tools that you need for eternal life. If you never obeyed the gospel, don't take the Bible lightly. Take it seriously, because it is, in fact, the Word of God. And I hope these places help bring the reality of that, at least bring it back up to the surface of our thinking, so that it becomes an obsession for us to keep reading the Bible daily. Never obey the gospel you want to today. You need to be on the Lord's side. We can help you in your obedience to Him. Please let your wishes be made. Come forward as we stand together and sing this song.
The great physician now is here, the sympathizing Jesus. He speaks the drooping heart to cheer. Oh, hear the voice of Jesus. Sweet is
thanking the Heavenly Father for this cup and for this bread that fitly represents Christ's body on the cross. We ask that those who take up the loaf at this time, take it in a way and supple manner with thee in Christ's name. Likewise, Heavenly Father, we ask that you bless the cup, the fruit of the vine, so that it represents Christ's blood that was shed on the cross, that they may have remission, that we have the opportunity to have remission for our sins. We ask that those who take of it do so in acceptable manner in Christ's name. Amen. Any other announcements? Anything needs to be said at this time? Anything else? I guess we'll have a closing prayer.
Our all-wise Father in heaven, you who are from everlasting to everlasting, we're thankful, Father, that you are there for us and that you care for us so much. We're thankful for the lesson tonight and for the fact that the Bible has accounts such as this that has been brought out tonight and previous lessons that give us the knowledge that these places were real and that the events happened, and we can have our faith strengthened by knowing that your word is true. These things attest to the truth of your word. We're thankful, Father, for that, and we're thankful that you are mindful of us to deliver your word to us in such a way that we can read and understand and obey your will. Father, we're mindful that there are those that have not done that. We pray that they will take every opportunity to look into your will and study and internalize those things and meditate upon them and know that you are real and that you have a plan for us and you have a plan for each life that involves obedience, submission and obedience to Jesus. And we pray that everyone who has not done that might think of that and do it before it's too late. Father, we pray that you'd be with those mentioned here today that are in need of our prayers, especially Willie, and pray that you'd be with him and Larson as they continue to deal with serious situations. We pray that you'd be with those others that were mentioned being sick and help them. We pray that you'd be with us as we depart. Help us to look forward to the next time that we'll be together. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.